More than 150 writers, activists, and academics have signed an open letter saying freedom of speech is under threat in North America. It was published in Harper's magazine, an American magazine. It's called A Letter on Justice and Open Debate. The signatories talk about the loss of support, popularity, or even employment that can result from expressing opinions perceived as racist, sexist, or transphobic. It acknowledges and applauds the protests for greater equality and inclusion in society, but it also says the exchange of ideas and information is becoming more restricted. For example, here's an excerpt. This needed reckoning has also intensified a new set of moral attitudes and political commitments that tend to weaken our norms of open debate and toleration of differences in favor of ideological conformity. As we applaud the first development, we also raise our voices against the second. Let's talk to one of the people who put their names on that letter. Steven Pinker is a Canadian psychologist, linguist, and author. He's a professor at Harvard University, and he joins me now from Truro, Massachusetts. Steven, welcome to you.
Thank you. Good evening.
Why did you feel it was important to put your name on this letter?
There is a regime of intimidation against differences of opinion. The letter is not about us. It's really about the people who have been cowed into not expressing opinions out of a legitimate fear that they will be fired or shamed. The result being that there are many answers to questions we may never know if we can't even discuss the possible hypotheses.
How do you know that there are people who feel that they can't express themselves?
There are, they have written to me and they said, this is what I think, but there's no way I'm ever going to say it. And there are notorious cases of people who have been fired, who've had fellowships supporting them withdrawn after a mobbing by academic signatories demanding that the fellowship be rescinded. There are cases of people being fired after expressing an unpopular opinion. So the abuses are real.
Some have argued, and I saw a lot of these arguments online today, that what the letter calls swift and severe retribution in response to perceived transgressions of speech and thought is simply people in positions of power and influence being held accountable for inappropriate and harmful behavior. What do you say to that?
Well, a difference of opinion is not harmful behavior, and that it is a vast misconception in a lot of the current discussion and debate that if you say something that goes against the popular consensus, you have committed a harm. It's as if people can't bear to hear an opinion that they disagree with or that they've never heard before, that it is wounding. And of course, whenever there's a difference of opinion, someone's feelings are going to get hurt, but we would never discover anything about anything if we followed that rule. And again, the letter was not about the signatories. The signatories used their prominence in order to call attention to what's happening to the less powerful, the people who have been fired and silenced for expressing unorthodox opinions.
What's been the reaction to you for having signed it?
I've gotten mostly letters of support, letters from people who've said, thank goodness not all academics and journalists have lost their mind, that there is still a current of sanity. So for me, the response has been almost entirely positive, though I'm aware of some of the controversy on Twitter, though Twitter, of course, is not a random sample of literate humanity.
How have academics and journalists lost their mind?
Oh, by treating unorthodox opinions as a kind of heresy that must be punished and sanctioned rather than evaluated and debated. And by the general narrowing of opinion, so a very small sliver of left-wing thought is considered to be obviously correct, and even liberals are considered to be, by that standard, right-wingers. I often say that academia is at the left pole, the mythical location from which all directions are right.
Yeah. Two of the signatories to the letter have now publicly distanced themselves from this letter, one of them saying she didn't know who else was signing the letter, many speculating she was referring to J.K. Rowling, and who recently came under fire for comments she made on Twitter about the trans community. What's your reaction to that?
We're kind of missing the point that if you're in favor of free speech, that means speech among those that you disagree with. Everyone's in favor of free speech for themselves and for people they agree with. But if you're uncomfortable defending free speech because you disagree with other people who are defending free speech, you really don't get free speech.
Well, we asked a lot of people to come on and talk about this tonight, and they seem to be very busy, unusually. But one of the main arguments we're seeing around, you know, the defense of free speech, people are saying free speech does not mean free from consequences, that people are allowed their opinion but must accept the consequences of expressing it.
Well, if the consequences are that people can criticize, disagree, then absolutely. The consequences are that you get fired, then that sets up a regime of intimidation, which means that certain opinions will never be expressed, to the disadvantage of everyone, because no one's infallible, no one's omniscient. The only way we can discover the way the world works and how to improve it is if ideas get broached and evaluated and debated, and so that we can know which ones are right and which ones are wrong.
Haven't nefarious groups in the past and individuals used the argument of free speech to spread hate?
Not that I know of. And in any case, in the United States, by the way, hate speech is constitutionally protected, largely because you can always call an opinion that you disagree with hate speech, but except for certain circumscribed exceptions, each one individually justified, such as extortion, blackmail, incitement to imminent violence. Speech is not restricted on the basis of its content, precisely because if you have vague categories, that is a license to suppress anything that you disagree with.
Okay, some people think that the people who signed this letter, or the contents of this letter, amount to trying to suppress the speech and the expression of the less powerful.
It's a fallacy to say that expressing an opinion is to silence or to drown out other opinions. Unless there are actual sanctions, that is, unless you're actually getting someone fired or mobbed, then there's nothing silencing about expressing an opinion.
Where do you think this argument's going to go?
Hard to predict, but there is a sense that an influential minority of extremists has intimidated people into silence. Everyone now is tempted to denounce others in fear that they will be denounced first, which calls for at least some public expression of values that perhaps a large majority of people believe, namely that it's okay to express disagreement, that not everyone who disagrees with the consensus is a racist or a transphobe. And I think there's going to be a great deal of relief that a number of people have stepped forward. People who disagree with each other often hate each other's guts, but they all do agree on the need to be able to express unpopular opinions.
Steven Pinker, thank you for joining us tonight.
Thank you for having me.